his speed, never take that for granted, appreciate the trust that you've got for it. I had worked all night, got about 2 hours of sleep before church this morning, so I went home after church, I laid down for a nap, and when I woke up, I didn't know what day it was, what time it was, whether I was going to work, just came home from work, so I'm still a little bit out of the loop right now. It's very rare that I ever sleep that sound, but I guess I was tired. But this word has been in my spirit for the last week. About 3 weeks ago, Pastor asked me to prepare to speak, and you preachers will understand this. It's either feast or famine. There's no in between. Either you've got five things in the works at once, or you've got nothing. It was one of those times I had a couple things churning in my mind, but nothing that I felt was what God was wanting to say right now. The last Sunday morning, the Lord woke me up with these words. As I began to study and research, I felt that this was a right now word. And I'm not speaking just to this church, but for the body of Christ on a much wider scale. So I hope I won't bore you with historical facts, because you understand exactly what is being said. We're going to have to go back into a little bit of history, but I hope that the spiritual parallels will be clear and you'll understand exactly what I'm saying. Reading from Isaiah tonight, chapter 10. That should be no surprise. I think the last three times I've spoken, it's been from the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 10. I'm only reading a portion of a verse. The very last phrase of verse 18. These are the words that woke me up from a sound sleep. And they shall be as when a standard bearer faints. They shall be as when a standard bearer faints. Let's pray. Lord, I need your help and your anointing tonight. Let your word go forth with power and anointing and demonstration of the Spirit. Speak to our hearts and encourage those who are downtrodden tonight. Those who feel they can't go another step, let the Spirit of God strengthen them and encourage them. Give them the grace to go over another mile. Speak to us through your word tonight. In Jesus' name, everybody said.
Amen.
When a standard bearer faints, I miss my amen corner over here.
Amen.
Fainting is always dangerous. At the very least, you're going to embarrass yourself. But there is the very real possibility of injury associated with fainting. Depending on where you are, broken bones, bruises, even brain bleeds can result from fainting. Fainting is never a good idea, but there are times when it is fatal to faint. You see, if you're at the mall and you pass out, you could get hurt. You might seriously injure yourself. But if you're driving a vehicle and you faint, somebody's going to die. 2 Samuel 21 recounts the story of a battle with the Philistines when David almost fainted. And the Bible says that a Philistine pressing his advantage was going to kill David, and he was saved from death only by the courage and strength of one of his soldiers. While fainting in general is dangerous, fainting in battle is fatal. The battlefield is the absolute worst place to faint. Our text speaks of a standard bearer fainting. This is where I had to do the research to understand exactly what the prophet was saying, what a standard bearer was, and what he did. So stay with me through the history lesson and we'll go somewhere. Standards have existed since the time of Noah, and every tribe in Israel had its own standard that it camped on. If you read the book of Leviticus, it told exactly what order they were to be set up under every standard. Some were flags, a pennants. Some were a carving that was put on a pole. But regardless of what form it took, it was significant for several reasons. Every military unit had its own standard. The purpose of the standard was threefold, especially as far as the military was concerned. The standard was the unit's identity. It was the standard that told you which group you belonged to when the infantry units were being assembled to go into battle.
You didn't just go join up with your best buddy because all your friends were in that group. It depended on which standard you belonged to. If the commanding officer called the 10th Legion or the 12th Legion or whatever, it was that standard that told him which company was at which point at any given moment. John 3:14, Jesus said, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up."
Amen.
It is the cross of Jesus Christ that is our common standard. Now, if you looked at the army, especially in Roman times, if you took away the standard, they all looked the same. Because the armor was indistinguishable. It was a generic. If you had no standard, there was no way to tell which army you were a part of. If there was no standard, there was no way to identify which side you were on. And this is what's happened in the church today. I believe this is what is wrong with the church today. The cross has been traded for other things. The cross has been substituted for other things, and we don't even know who we are anymore. We fight and we bicker between ourselves because if there is no identity, you don't know friend from foe. If there is no identity, you don't know who's on your side and who's fighting against you. We fight between ourselves when we should be fighting our mutual enemy because we've lost our identity. The only thing that separates us from world religions, the only thing that separates us from the drunkard on the street, from the addict in the alley, is that bloodstained cross of Jesus Christ. Take that away and there's no difference. Take that away and there's nothing to distinguish. It must be the cross that sets us apart from everybody else. Our identity is intrinsically bound up in the standard, but it goes further than that. The standard was the company's unity. No matter where the soldiers were, when that bugle sounded the call to arms, they all gathered beneath their standard. Tom didn't go streaking off south and Bill go north and Jim go east just because they thought that might be where the action was.
That's right.
They gathered beneath that standard and nobody moved until the standard moved. What's happened in the church today since we've decided that the cross is too gory and too offensive is that we've replaced it with other things and now everybody's doing their own thing. Somebody's off into hyper grace while somebody else is off into word of faith and another's off into kingdom now. And we're all going separate directions because there's nothing to pull us together and give us guidance. There's no unity in the church. We're fighting and quibbling about this, about that, about whether it's progressive or instantaneous, about where it's pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, where we're fighting about so many things because we've lost our identity and we've lost our unity. Everything is bound up in that standard. Unity cannot be regained until we come back to the cross. We've got a lot of people preaching about unity today. Oh, we need unity in the church. We need to join up with the Catholics and the Mormons and the Islamists. No. There's only one way unity can be achieved, and that's unity of the standard of God for the world. But a second benefit of the standard was that if in the battle one or more of the soldiers became separated from the unit, they could find the others by locating the standard. Because whether it was a call to retreat or a call to regroup, that standard was the focal point.
Amen.
That's where everybody was going. And if you found yourself separated and you didn't know where everybody else was, you could find the standard and find your way back to where you were supposed to be.
Amen.
How many people have gotten lost spiritually because they look for something to tell them where they were supposed to be? They look for something to tell them where the presence of God was. They look for something to tell them where the anointing of God was, but the standard had been removed and replaced by something else, and they could not find where they were supposed to be. No soldier was ever lost as long as he could see the standard. by the standard, it was the unit's direction. The movement of the standard told the troops which way to go. Whether they were doing a flank movement or going straight into the other company, they watched that standard to see which way we're supposed to go. Church, we're never going to be victorious in battle until we come back to looking to the cross for guidance and direction again. Psychology will point you the wrong way. Self-help books will leave you confused. Television preachers will have you going every direction. It is only the cross that will show you the way to go. It is a focused, disciplined soldier who learns to make the standard his final authority. But the standard doesn't wave automatically. For every standard, there must be a standard bearer. So let's talk about the person of the standard. Carrying the standard was considered the highest honor attainable in the military unit. There was nothing higher than being chosen to be the standard bearer. So this responsibility was given to the bravest soldier. The one who had proven that despite death and carnage all around him, he would not run. He must never, ever give up the standard. You see, it was considered, in ancient times, it was considered an act of courage to capture the opposing army's standard. So whoever carried the standard must be committed to preserving it even to the death. Because the loss of standard equaled the loss of honor. Oh, no, you didn't hear that. The loss of the standard equaled the loss of the honor. When did the American church, Pentecostal church, come to be ridiculed and looked at with derision in this nation? When we traded the cross for other things and we decided to be more like everybody else, to let our identity down so we wouldn't be so distinguishable anymore, so we wouldn't stand out anymore, and we lost our power, we lost our anointing, we lost our respect in the American world when we lost our standard. He must be committed to defending it even to his last breath. In fact, a portion of the Danish Oath of Allegiance to the standard reads this way. If in the battle the enemy should cut off your right hand, grasp the banner with your left hand. If you lose both your hands, grasp the banner by your teeth. You must safeguard it as long as you are alive and breathing. Are you forced to give up fighting? May God forbid that. You must wrap the banner around your body and die. God, give us preachers that when the strength is gone, the help is failing, and the voice is gone, they'll still wrap themselves in the blood-soaked banner of Jesus Christ and refuse to allow the enemy 1 inch of ground. Men and women who will not give up, who will not surrender the truth, will fight to the end to preserve the standard. The standard bearer had no weapons. He went into battle with only a small shield to protect himself, because he had to hold the standard above all else. But the other soldiers held the standard in such high regard, they would defend him at a moment's notice. Listen, church, sometimes the preacher gets tired. Sometimes we don't have what we need to defend ourselves from the attacks of the enemy that comes against us. We need fellow soldiers that will take up the charge, that will take up the challenge, and support and defend the truth of God's word. Usually the standard bearer marched close to the field officer, which meant he was on the front lines. This was the peril of the standard. You see, just as the standard told the unit which way to go, just as it provided their identity and their unity, it also showed the enemy where to shoot. In the charge, the battle, that the standard bearer was the first one going forward. So he caught the hottest barrage. As it was said of the Civil War, that just carrying the flag into battle made one an instant target. The highest mortality rate was the standard bearers, because they were the ones who were shot down first, going first in the battle. They were always in the thick of it. There was never a minute to catch their breath. They could never relax. There was never a moment to hide behind somebody else and just take a breather, because if that standard was not in place, the troops knew not what to do. So he had to always be quick on his feet if he wanted to keep both his head and his standard intact. Because if the standard went down, all hope was lost. If the standard went down, the army lost unity and direction. It was not uncommon for the whole unit to retreat simply because the standard bearer was shot down. That's how important the standard was to them. If it was not there, they threw up their hands. If it wasn't there, they said, we can't do this. If the standard wasn't there, they said, this is too hard. I'm going back to the barracks. So the standard bearer had to always be in the thick of the battle. Imagine for a moment that you're an Israeli soldier fighting against a fierce enemy. Now, in ancient times, when two armies joined battle, they didn't have the luxury of sitting several hundred yards away in a shell-proof tank firing rounds at each other. When they joined battle, it was hand to hand. And they would run into each company and cut down as many as possible before they retreated. Often in the fray, soldiers would become separated from their units. They would be surrounded by the enemy soldiers. The enemy would come between them and their comrades, and they couldn't see where the rest of their unit was. Now suppose you're a Jewish soldier, so you're 5'9 tops. You can't see over anybody's head. The opposing army has just made their charge, and you don't know if you're the only one standing or not. All you can see are dead bodies and enemy soldiers all the way around you. It'll do no good to yell, hey, Ma! Hey, Jim! Where y'all at? Nobody can hear over the noise of the battle. There's only one way to find out if anybody else survived the charge. You look around until you find a standard. Because that standard is going to be lifted high enough over the heads of everybody around you. You can spot it anywhere it's at. If you see the standard, it means you're not alone. If you see the standard, it means there's somebody fighting with you. To the isolated soldier, the standard was everything. It represented his hope, his purpose, and his passion. You could not conquer the soldier who could find his standard. But suppose the standard bearer has been shot down. Or suppose that from heat exhaustion and dehydration, the standard bearer has fainted. What happens to the isolated, surrounded soldier when he can't find the standard? It's simple. He surrenders. If there is no standard, it must mean the whole company has fallen. Or it must mean that their retreat has been ordered and he's the only one still on the battlefield. Or worse yet, it must mean that the commanding officer has been killed and there's nobody left in the fight. When a standard bearer faints, it sends the message that there's no hope of victory. It can't be done. And you're on your own. When the standard bearer faints, the soldier says, forget this. I can't do it anymore. This is why, as good soldiers of Jesus Christ, we must never for one moment let the standard down. Now understand, I'm not preaching only to ministers tonight. Every one of us have been called to be good soldiers of Jesus Christ. And when one standard bearer is shot down, another must pick up the standard and go on. It doesn't matter whether you're called a pulpit ministry or not. You're called to carry the cross to a lost isolated away from saying I can't do this. It's not worth it. Nobody stands for biblical values anymore. Nobody believes in holiness anymore. Nobody believes in moral absolutes anymore. I'm done. I quit. If the standard is not lifted high, if the cross is not visible above all else, some weary soldier somewhere is going to give up in the fight. Yeah, you'll be a target. You'll get weary. But don't you dare faint. Some soldier somewhere is looking to your standard for the courage to carry on. Somebody who's been isolated from the rest of the group and surrounded by the enemy under constant attack, they're looking for that standard to know there's somebody still on their side. Stories told of an army marching up a hill against a fortified enemy. As always, the standard bearer went first, ahead of the company. Enemy fire was very effective because they were entrenched on the hill. The company was rather badly shot up. The field officer considered the whole thing a loss, and he called to the standard bearer to bring the standard down. I love this. The standard bearer shouted back to the officer, "I will not bring the standard down. You bring up your men." From every corner today, we hear the cry to bring the standard down. It's too exclusive. It's too offensive. It's too boring. You need to blend in. You need to understand the culture. Don't mention the blood. Don't mention the cross. Don't mention repentance. Don't mention judgment. Lower the standard. But is there anybody in the house tonight that'll shout to a backslidden, seeker-sensitive church, "We will not bring the standard down"? You bring the church up. You bring the ministry up. You bring the standard. We will not for 1 minute lower us. Come back to me.